up on Dialogue Weekend. October 25th marks the 75th anniversary of Taiwan's return from Japan to China, where are cross-strait relations headed today? Japan's new Prime Minister, Yoshihide Suga, visits Vietnam and Indonesia on his first trip abroad. What's the new leader's vision for the Indo-Pacific? And this week's newsmaker, now on Dialogue Weekend.
Hello, welcome to Dialogue Weekend. I'm Xu Qianduo. If you want to understand it today, you have to search yesterday. Well, Sunday marks the 75th anniversary of Taiwan's return to China at the end of Japanese rule on October 25th, 1945. So how significant is that part of history to today's situation surrounding Taiwan, in particular to the understanding of the well-known One China principle? So what's the solution to a peaceful reunification of China? For that discussion, we have in the studio Anna Tangen, independent current affairs commentator, and from Shanghai, Professor Chen Hong from East China Normal University. So welcome to the show, Tangen and Chen, Professor Chen here. Professor Chen, let me start with you the question, you know, that part of history, you know, Taiwan was returned from Japan to China. Give us some background, you know, what is behind that?
Yes, I think actually because the secession of Taiwan to Japan actually after actually the Japanese Navy defeated the Chinese Navy, the Qing Dynasty Navy, you know, that was actually part of the beginning of the start of the history of humiliation of China, the century, or what we call the century of humiliation for China, actually for China, an independent sovereign nation to be giving up part of its territory to the rule of Japan. And that actually had started, you know, a kind of like a series of foreign, you know, colonization and also foreign, you know, occupation. That was actually really, you know, cast such long shadow, you know, in the Chinese history. And the end of the Second World War, after the end of the Second World War, you know, when Taiwan was returned to China, and when the Japanese rule through the Japanese colonization was brought to an end, that actually was very important as Taiwan was emerging out of its historical stain into, you know, a kind of like its legal, you know, status as, you know, part of China. That was very significant. When we celebrate the 75th anniversary of the end of the Japanese rule, it is not only a celebration of the past, but in fact a reconfirmation of the status quo. That is actually Taiwan is a part of China. That is actually an undeniable fact. That is why actually I think this is particularly important for us to celebrate, to remember, and also to learn from the historical, you know, historical lessons, and also to re-establish our understanding of the history, and also have our, you know, understanding of the future.
Mm-hmm. Well, Anna, you know, that part of history, you know, Taiwan was returned from Japanese colonial rule when it was ended, of course, to China as part of China. So how significant it is, you know, when it is coming to today's geopolitical situation, your history never far away.
No, it isn't. And the difficulty here is that the U.S. has now embarked on a very aggressive arms sale to Taiwan, $1.8 billion. And what's unique about this is there had always been an understanding that there would be no offensive weapons, no weapons that could reach the mainland. And this is the real issue and why you're seeing so much activity around the Korean War, around this anniversary.
Yeah.
So, because China is making it clear that it will not allow any of its territory to be taken, even though it's an asymmetrical military situation. The U.S. spends more than half of the entire world's total of for its army and navy and defense. China is a fraction of that. They know that, but they're signaling that this happened before in the Korean War, and they will certainly be willing to and be resolved to take this step again if their territorial interests are threatened.
Mm-hmm. Well, Professor Chen, obviously, you know, there's a bottom line for China, and also diplomatically, it is important to recognize this part of history, you know, Taiwan, why Taiwan, you know, is recognized as part of China, why there's one China principle. And of course, in Beijing, there's a senior Chinese official, you know, speaking at the commemoration, making it very clear that, you know, that China will never allow Taiwan to be separated from China. So tell us, you know, what's your understanding of the Chinese policy over the Taiwan issue, and also the Chinese, the attitudes toward Taiwan in terms of vis-a-vis the U.S. support to Taiwan?
Yeah, I think actually Taiwan has been used, you know, taken advantage of by the Trump administration as a kind of a pawn, you know, in its contestation with China. So that actually when, you know, the so-called, you know, Taiwan issue or Taiwan problem, there's no problem about Taiwan. There's no issue about Taiwan. Taiwan is part of China. That is an undeniable fact. But in this understanding, when, you know, the United States is particularly, you know, interested in instigating, you know, mobilizing, you know, all factors, you know, to make China, you know, to be, you know, in a kind of difficult situation, in particular against the background of the context of the COVID-19 pandemic, so that actually China is, the whole world is engaged in this economic, you know, difficulties, and the United States is obviously using the separatism, you know, in Taiwan that has been, you know, emerging in the recent years, you know, to, you know, challenge the bottom line of Beijing, of China. You know, I think actually the Taiwan issue is unnegotiable. There's no, you know, no room of compromisation at all, you know, for China. You know, this is the bottom line, and that is it. And there's no, no possibility of any kind of, you know, negotiation, you know, in terms of sovereignty and also national, you know, territorial integrity.
The future of Taiwan, of course, occasion is marked not only in the mainland but also in Taiwan, in particular by the KMT, you know, the opposition party in Taiwan. So one KMT official said that, you know, despite their financial difficulties, so they are trying to seek support, you know, to hold activities to mark this occasion. But the leader in Taiwan, Tsai Ing-wen, from the Democratic Progressive Party, which is independence mandate, refused to participate in such activity. So, you know, what's her considerations here, Professor Chen?
I think actually the Tsai Ing-wen regime, as I said, have been, you know, taking advantage of the current situation in which the United States is lodging its all-around war, you know, technological, economic, and various other aspects, you know, all kind of, you know, campaigns, anti-China campaigns. So actually, you know, for the Tsai Ing-wen regime, you know, this is a kind of like, you know, an opportunity for the regime to try to mobilize all possible, you know, external factors to help it to distance itself from the Chinese mainland. This is actually a particularly cunning trick for the regime in Taiwan, because this is what they were perceiving, you know, this the current situation as a kind of opportunity to trying to increase, or even not only to retain, you know, to maintain the current, you know, distance between the Chinese mainland and also Taiwan, but in fact actually trying to increase, you know, the distance. And on the other hand, of course, this is also being used as a way to instigate a kind of like a separatist, you know, send a mentality among the people in Taiwan, in particular, you know, among the younger generation, so that actually, you know, for the Tsai Ing-wen authorities, you know, that is actually a kind of like opportunity. That is why I don't think actually Tsai Ing-wen will be really commemorating this this event, because for the Tsai Ing-wen authorities, the more, you know, distance, you know, Taiwan is from the Chinese mainland, the better.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is an uncomfortable part of history for the DPP, obviously. And, you know, they also revised the history books for the young people, basically by glorifying the period, the colonial period, by the Japanese. They say this is basically, that's, you know, vision of civilization and rewriting of history. And Tangen, you know, is that for, I don't know, for cultivating a new identity or cultivating a closer relationship with Taiwan, with Japan, against the mainland?
Well, it's just against the mainland. I mean, they're trying to forge this new identity. They're Chinese, but they're trying to create this sense of difference. There were a lot of factors that went into it, especially they do sense because of they use complex script and things like that. But they're taking those things out of proportion, and it's purely political. Remember, Tai Ing-wei, but for the disturbances in Hong Kong, and the question is, how were those created and instigated?
Right.
She would not be the premier today. She was had been, you know, completely sidelined in a massive overthrow of her local party at the local level, and she was slated. She had stepped down as the party leader. But so this is really the only way that she can keep herself in the game is to continue this kind of thing. But the danger here, and this is right, is. Countries like India are now seizing on Taiwan as a pressure point. And I've actually heard somebody say on one of the television programs that I was participating on, says, if we don't get our way at the border in the Himalayas, we will contract with Taiwan, and then China will be sorry. So you're starting to see people mix, countries start to mix security and trade issues, and it's really sad.
It's getting more complicated. Professor Chen, I want to have your comment on what Tang mentioned about the Indian move into this this very dangerous area. For people who probably understand very little about the situation, like for China, this is the bottom line about the territorial integrity, about the national unification.
Yes.
There's no way, basically no room, to step back from that point. Point. So, when it comes to China-India relationship, what's the way forward if India somehow playing with the Taiwan card?
I think actually for the Indian side, this is a kind of adventurism, which is very risky, because actually India is challenging China's bottom line. It is not only challenging China's, claim of the territories, disputed territories in dispute between China and also India, but actually India is playing the Taiwan card. It seems actually, the Indian side is actually thinking about emulating the United States to play the Taiwan card, to exert pressure upon China, thinking that China will be giving up, because of its concerns, about the national integrity. But this is definitely, as I said, a kind of like adventurism. There's no possibility that China will be, making any compromise about, issues in particular about, national territorial integrity, including, the Taiwan. Because for Taiwan, this is definitely, something that is without any, room of compromise. That is why I think actually for China will definitely be taking very, very resolute countermeasures if actually India is determined to play the Taiwan card. I think that would be a very, very, unwise, or should I say, put it frankly, a very, very stupid move if India is going to play the so-called Taiwan card.
Mm-hmm. Well, hopefully cooler heads will prevail in New Delhi. Let's move on to Japan. Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga has wrapped up a four-day trip to Vietnam and Indonesia, his first foreign visit since taking office in September. Tokyo agreed with Hanoi and Jakarta to step up their bilateral ties in both defense and economic fields. The trip came as Asian countries are focusing on a recovery of their economies while keeping the coronavirus under control. It took place also at a time when the U.S. is building an alliance to contain the rise of China. To learn more about the trip and its potential geopolitical implications, we are joined by Takesato Watanabe, Professor Emeritus at Doshisha University. So welcome to our show, Professor. Here, obviously, the for any country, the new leader, the first trip of the new leader will be paid a lot of attention. So here, Prime Minister Suga did not choose the United States, nor China, and his choice is Vietnam and Indonesia. Why, Professor Watanabe?
Prime Minister Suga said when he succeeded to the position of PM, he said very clearly that he will do nothing new and he will follow all the lines set by former Prime Minister Abe. Abe's idea is to have the very close relations with the United States first, and not so friendly toward some other Asian countries, especially China, because Mr. Abe's and also Mr. Suga's ancestors, they are closely related to the colonial, you see, occupancy of China and Korean Peninsula. Especially Suga, his father was staying in Manchuria, and he came back from that area to Japan after the war. But Mr. Suga was educated in the principle, economic principle and political principle, that Japan is superior to any other part in East Asian community area. So this is the story behind the first activities of Mr. Suga.
Mm-hmm. Well, Tangen, here, you know, the continuation of Abe foreign policy. We know Abe foreign policy basically is like a global diplomacy, and her and his prime ministership basically, you know, that Japan is not somehow satisfied with being an ally of the United States. Japan has global ambition here. Now they're starting, they are focusing on, let's say, you know, first instance, the ASEAN countries, Vietnam and Indonesia. What do you make of that?
Well, they see China, ASEAN has become China's largest trade partner, and this is somewhat threatening to Japan. They want supremacy in those areas. Now, Vietnam is the current chairman of ASEAN, and Indonesia is the largest country, most populous country in ASEAN. So it made sense for him to try to go to these entities and say, listen, start trading with us, we'll give you things. But the fact is, there's not a lot of money in the kitty. I don't care if it's Japan or Europe or the United States, all of these countries are borrowing heavily to deal with the costs of COVID-19, which are still yet undetermined because we haven't emerged from it. So he's taking, yes, he's continuing on a path, but it's not clear that he has the means to actually do something on that path. These countries are in need. I was doing a seminar on Indonesia with the university, and they said quite clearly they are looking for help just with the basic things. And right now there just isn't a lot of money even for their own economies, let alone other countries. China is different. Its economy continues to grow. It's going to be the only one out there, and it is not talk. China has switched a lot of its economic activity towards ASEAN, and it intends to continue, especially with Belt and Road and possibly RCEP.
Mm-hmm. Well, Professor Chen, you know, if you look at the trip to these two countries by Prime Minister Suga, so the ties, you know, he tried to cement is not only about the economic relationship with Vietnam and Jakarta, Indonesia, but also, you know, selling weapons, equipment to Vietnam and to Indonesia. Somehow Japan is seeking to increase its presence about this South China Sea issue. Will that be helpful to solve the problem or somehow deteriorate the situation there?
I think actually firstly, Japan is a country with strategic aspirations. It is not contented with its current status quo. That's why the former Prime Minister Abe has been, you know, trying to, you know, make some changes to the constitution as well as the Japanese army status. So that is why I think actually for on the chessboard of the Japanese strategists, you know, there's definitely a lot of, you know, interest in this region, the ASEAN region, in the Southeast Asian region, you know, to increase the presence, to increase its you know, influence, you know, in this region. On the other hand, obviously we know about this outcry about the quad, you know, the quadrilateral dialogue between, you know, among you know the United States, you know Japan, India, and also Australia. That is actually part of almost like serving as a kind of axis of the United States Indo-Pacific strategy, which is purported to contain, deter, and even to crush China's peaceful developments. So between you know and obviously as we can see that actually the ASEAN countries they sit in a very comfortable you know easy you know region that is between the two oceans. That is why I think actually this particular area has been given particular considerations by you know United States and also its closest allies in the Pacific. That is obviously you know Japan. That's why I think Prime Minister Suga you know attaches such importance to this area in particular, you know, with regard to security and also politics.
Mm-hmm. Well, Professor Watanabe, you know, also we noticed that Prime Minister Suga stressed that Japan is not aiming at creating an Asian version of NATO, targeting any at specific country here, obviously China. So is he trying to make a difference from the U.S. policy of building up alliance against China?
If we consider only the military power or economic power in Asia, China, Japan, and India, these are three the biggest countries in this area. However, India is very independent from the United States mostly, but Vietnam and Indonesia are very friendly with the United States, militarily and economically. But United States and Japan, they don't want to, you see, shake hands with China because China is independent. America is, you see, considering China is the hypothetical enemy. So Suga considered how to promote his position up in the international arena, then he had to choose Vietnam and Indonesia, who cannot be independent militarily and economically without China, without India. Then the position of Japan in these activities will be bigger and better in the influence of any field of this area. United States doesn't say anything as for the independent activities of Mr. Suga, considering their own benefits. This is what he calls strategic co-prosperity planning of international world.
Mm-hmm. Well, Tangen, you know, Japan, the Japanese government has tried to diversify the so-called supply chain away from China, either bring them back to Japan or somehow have their production relocated, say, in Southeast Asian countries. How successful is that?
Well, it's not going to be successful, but China is the largest market for Japanese goods. It's just a pipe dream. It was something that was said for nationalist feeling, but it's literally, you don't see anybody leaving the Chinese market, and quite the opposite, especially the automotive markets are doubling down here. They need this market in order to succeed. But going back to this point, I want to draw a parallel between our first discussion and this one. Japan is on one thing saying, oh, we're not trying to upset anybody, but by the way, we're going to participate in a quadrilateral series of things which are aimed directly at China. Now, they can say they're not, but if you talk to India, they clearly say that they're participating in the Quad to contain China. So is the U.S. So them saying that they're participating in a group that's goal is to contain China, but they're not trying to contain China, is hypocritical.
Playing the game, probably.
Why say it? If you're doing something, do it. Don't pretend that you're not.
That's Japan, I guess. Well, let's leave it there for now and take a look at this week's newsmaker. Joining us now is David Ma Hong, Executive Chairman of Ma Hong China Investment Management. Mr. Ma Hong here, you know, the Labour Party and the leadership of Jacinda Ardern obviously has won almost 50% of the vote, which is yet to be completed. But this is history-making. For decades, the first time that a party will be able to actually establish a government without it. Seeking coalition from other parties. Obviously, the popularity of the Prime Minister played a role in that big victory. So what has made Ms. Ardern so popular with the New Zealanders?
I think it's deeper than popularity. Mm-hmm. She's been tested as Prime Minister over the last 3 years quite severely. The first test was the slaughter by a right-wing extremist of Muslims in a mosque in Christchurch. And the way she handled that, the way she conveyed sincerity and empathy, and the way she dealt with the issue of racism in what is quite a diverse, multicultural country, was well respected. Then we have COVID, of course, and I think apart from China and a handful of North Asian countries, most countries have not managed COVID at all. They've put economy before people. They've put their own a fear of losing popularity above listening to scientists. She was the opposite of that. So in a sense followed China's model, an early and severe lockdown. And so New Zealand came through COVID very well, and we're relatively COVID free. The country is just as open as China is for travel, and people are traveling without fear. So she certainly won the respect of New Zealanders, and that's why they voted for her in such numbers.
Mm-hmm. Well, of course, you know, she speaks of multilateralism, and she's basically the opposite of Donald Trump in terms of COVID-19, you know, treatment there. And what about her and her party's promise, you know, in the first term? Critics say, you know, those promises, not all, at least not every promise is being made true.
Well, the previous government she led was a coalition, and one of the partners was a party called New Zealand First, which is essentially a right-wing party that bases its populism on engendering fear in people, particularly fear of Asians and specifically fear of China. So Winston Peters is now gone from the political scene, and he was the coalition partner. She had no choice but to work with him. And a lot of anti-Chinese sentiment was whipped up. A lot of our foreign affairs endeavors in Asia were put in peril. And we have a long, good relationship with China, 40 years of standing on our own outside of other Western countries' positions. And he was dragging us back to a US position. And also on domestic policy, attempts at building affordable housing, the alleviation of poverty, and taking on some of the major environmental challenges for what is a largely farming nation in terms of our exports, her government was blocked. So now she's free to govern without coalition partners. There is a high chance that many of these plans, these endeavors, will be met. But there's one problem, and that is that the West, led by the US, is largely trying to beat up on China. Australia is one of the major partners in American endeavors in that way. And there's a lot of pressure on her government to be more Western in its approach. And that pressure is going to increase in this first year of her second term. And if Biden wins, it's going to be easier for countries to be closer to the US rather than the odious Donald Trump that currently makes it quite easy to say no. So I'm a bit worried how our foreign policy may go forward, because there is a general trend in the West of fearing China, and there are these coalitions of interests trying to contain China. It won't succeed, but I'd be very sorry if our country joined that group.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Ma Hong. And with that, we are coming to the end of today's show. Many thanks to our guests, Tan Ken, Professor Chen. You can also watch us on the CGTN app or on the YouTube. I'm Xu Qinduo. You can find me on Twitter, Xu Qinduo. Thanks for watching. See you next week.